Coming up on today's program, how to stay younger longer. One doc's going to share his clinically proven prescription for life. And then, secrets.
Something breaks inside of you.
Stripping.
You're gonna pay me for it.
And suicidal thoughts.
Because what's the point?
How she found salvation.
Nothing can give you freedom like that.
On today's 700 Club.
Well, welcome to this edition of the 700 Club. Yesterday we had with us, or at least that was on the phone with me before the show, Steve Weber, our director in the Ukraine. He said the Russians were getting ready to move on the Ukraine. And indeed, that's the story today. The Russian bear is on the prowl, and it could be bringing nuclear weapons with it. The top military commander for NATO is warning that Russia is sending troops into Ukraine, along with tanks and deadly heavy artillery.
Russia denies it, but Moscow has been flexing its military muscles in other parts of the world as well, including near the United States. Caitlin Burke has the story.
Russia appears to be making a move. Tanks, artillery, and troops all being moved into Ukraine, according to General Philip Breedlove, the commander of NATO forces in Europe.
We see forces that are capable of being nuclear that are being moved to Crimea. Whether they are or not, we do not know, but they do have the kind of equipment there that could support that mission if required.
The UN Security Council met for an emergency meeting Wednesday to address the situation in Ukraine. Officials warned that the area is on the verge of returning to serious fighting.
We are deeply concerned over the possibility of a return to full-scale fighting. Alternatively, the conflict may simmer in this way for months, with sporadic low-level battles marked by periods of increased hostilities and further casualties.
Russia denies that it's preparing for renewed military action. They say that Russian volunteers are simply crossing into Ukraine to support pro-Russian separatists. General Breedlove estimates that between 250 to 300 Russian personnel are currently inside Ukraine.
My biggest concern right now is that this force, this capability that is being moved into eastern Ukraine, will be used to more consolidate the edges of this area in order to make it a more contiguous, more easy to control and employ region.
Meanwhile, in a show of force against the West, Russia announced that it will restart long-range bomber patrols from the Arctic Ocean to the Caribbean and the Gulf of Mexico. Military analysts say the extended Russian bomber patrols are just another way of displaying the power of the Russian military. In September, Russian strategic bombers near Canada practiced cruise missile strikes on the U.S. And in May, Russian planes flew within 50 miles of the coast of California. Caitlin Burke, CBN News.
Thanks, Caitlin. Steve Weber told me yesterday that the ruse that the Russians will be using would be to send KGB people into the Ukraine who would set off explosives and look like that they were the Ukrainian military trying to suppress the separatists. And therefore, that would be the provocation that Putin would need in order to invade. That's what's coming, and so keep your eyes on the news. But this will be a terrible thing, and Obama's got his mind on stuff that's not really important these days, and this is one that Putin knows he's dealing with a weak opponent, and he's going to take every advantage he possibly can find. Well, in other news, the Obama administration may be looking for a new strategy against Syria and ISIS. John Jessup has that story from our CBN News Bureau in Washington. Here's John.
Pat, the United States has been trying to defeat ISIS in Iraq and then go after Islamic State fighters in Syria, but that strategy isn't working. And according to sources from CNN, the president has asked his national security team to review U.S. policy towards Syria so that the Syrian rebels don't have to take on ISIS and President Bashar Assad at the same time. Top advisors in the Obama administration have long argued that the current strategy wouldn't work. Well, why would a woman leave her home and family to join the ISIS terrorists? We've learned a shocking number of young women are among the thousands of Westerners headed to the Middle East. Eric Stackelbeck has this look at the women of jihad.
For months before Shannon Conley's arrest, FBI agents met with her repeatedly. They warned the 19-year-old Muslim convert that her plan to travel to Syria and help ISIS was illegal. Conley, however, had made up her mind. She wanted to leave her suburban Denver home to marry an ISIS fighter she had met online. Agents stopped her at Denver's airport before she could carry out her plan. Yet there are many more like her.
Last month, three teenage girls, also from suburban Denver, were detained while trying to make their way to Syria. But hundreds of other young women from Western countries have made it to the Islamic State, marrying ISIS fighters and even fighting alongside them.
I have a huge concern regarding the women going back, because that's, again, a part of building a new society. That's the marketing that's going on. And a lot of women here are finding that an attractive option.
Bob Fletcher is the former sheriff of Ramsey County in Minnesota, which includes the city of St. Paul. At least four Somali women from St. Paul and neighboring Minneapolis have traveled to Syria to join ISIS in recent months.
While they're recruiting men, they promise them wives when they get there. They need women in their society to keep their fighters content. It's a scary thing, but the women are really being used in a variety of ways once they get there.
In some cases, these women act as much more than mere jihadi brides. A group of British women reportedly leads an all-female Sharia police unit inside the ISIS-controlled Syrian city of Raqqa. These British citizens enforce Islamic dress codes and even reportedly run a brothel where they provide sex slaves to ISIS fighters. So far, most of the ISIS women come from Europe. The numbers include at least 50 British women, 40 from Germany, and some 60 French girls and young women, all leaving their homes to join the Islamic State. The so-called poster girls for this movement are a pair of Austrian teenagers who are believed to be living in Syria and married to ISIS fighters. The girls are reportedly pregnant and want to come home.
Al-Qaeda, extremists, what they call ISIS, Al-Shabaab, I believe for the girls, they're using their element of surprise.
There is a precedent for female terrorists. Dozens of Muslim women from Chechnya and Dagestan have carried out suicide bombings against Russian targets in recent years. But ISIS is taking things to another level by actively recruiting women online. ISIS promises them husbands and a wonderful new life in the caliphate, a place where, ironically enough, women have no rights or freedoms. Eric Stackelbeck, CBN News, Washington.
It appears President Obama is closer to taking executive action on illegal immigrants. Fox News reports the president may announce a 10-point immigration plan as soon as next week. President Obama had already pledged to take action on immigration before the end of the year. The plan could allow up to 4.5 million illegal immigrant adults with American-born children to stay in the U.S. Republicans in Congress oppose executive action by the president, with some recommending ways to stop it. Pat?
Well, this is an example of the so-called imperial presidency. We just can't allow this to happen. The president acts like that election did not take place. The election was an overwhelming repudiation of him and his policies. And now we are going to have some polls coming up in just a minute showing how the American people feel in regard to a number of major issues. But in regard to immigration, why start a fight? Why start a fight? Why poison the waters when Mitch McConnell and other Republicans are more than willing to go halfway and to make some kind of accord in order to help the nation? But all Obama thinks of is playing politics, and this is a political gamble. He pushes the Republicans on this. They're not prepared to have comprehensive immigration legislation because you want something that really will be lasting. But he's forcing them to take a position where they'll vote against it. And then he'll go to the Hispanics and say, you see, they're against you. I mean, it's strictly a political ploy. And yet, to think that the president, all he thinks about is partisan politics. By nature, he's a community organizer made on the model of a radical left winger. And that's what we got. And, you know, the people say, what can we do about it? Well, it's time for Congress to take bold action. But the American people need to understand that you can't always have sweetness and light. They can't always be harmony. Some people have to stand up for principle. John.
Pat, the public favors Republicans in Congress taking charge of policy in Washington rather than President Obama. According to a new Gallup poll, 56% of Americans would rather have Republicans have more influence on the direction of the country, while only 36% prefer the president. Republicans have a 42% favorable approval rating, and Democrats have a 36% favorable rating. The president's approval rating sits at just 39%, with a 56% unfavorable rating. Well, both houses of Congress are finally voting on the Keystone Pipeline. The project got new life on Capitol Hill Wednesday after Senate Democrats abandoned efforts to block the measure in hopes of giving some political cover to Louisiana Senator Mary Landrieu. She faces a runoff election next month. The White House says the president is taking a dim view of legislative efforts to force action on the oil pipeline. Landrieu has supported the Keystone Project in the past. If she loses the runoff, Republicans will have a gain of 9 seats from this year's midterm elections. Well, more than a month away from the official start of winter, some parts of the U.S. are already deep in snow. The polar blast has made its way through the heartland, dumping record-breaking snow in some states. Northern Michigan was buried under more than 3 feet of snow. In Denver, temperatures dropped a range of 60 degrees in just 24 hours, causing hundreds of flights to be canceled and havoc on the roads. The Arctic air is now making its way to the East Coast and is expected to linger through the middle of next week. Pat, time to bundle up. Winter's come early.
Man, I have a warm coat on. I am ready.
You are.
Wendy, you from West Virginia.
It's going to be a white Thanksgiving, I think, not just a white Christmas.
Good. Well, you know, when I was a kid, that was normal. I lived in a little town called Lexington, Virginia, in the Shenandoah Valley of Virginia. And it was nothing to have snow on Thanksgiving. I mean, heavy snow.
Yeah.
And there were two schools, Virginia Tech, which is used to be called VPI, and VMI, Virginia Military, and they were two rivals, and they played on Thanksgiving Day. So it was a football game played in the snow, and that was standard. Now we think, Thanksgiving, snow, a big deal.
Weather is secular. It goes in cycles, and now we're in another very snowy.
We're not in global warming. Just fix it in your mind, folks. We're in a colder, it'll be colder for the next several decades, then it'll start warming up again. Wendy.
All right. Well, coming up, a typhoon took her family, but it didn't take her faith.
No matter what storms may come, we must do our best to keep our faith in God. No matter what happens, God is always there.
Hear how she's become an inspiration to her community. That's next.
When tragedy strikes around the world, we're there to help. CBN is there. Operation Blessing is there. And last year's devastating typhoon in the Philippines killed more than 7,000 people. And more than a year later, hundreds of Filipinos are still missing. But in a coastal city destroyed by the storm, one family's heartbreaking loss has become an inspiration for many. George Thomas went over there to bring us this story from the city of Tacloban in the Philippines.
See, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. 13 of them are died, but the other are missing.
A year ago, on November 8, 2013, Dolor Lingo lost 13 members of her family.
At first, it was very painful, but slowly I've come to accept what has happened as the will of God.
Among those who died that day were three of her children, who drowned when tsunami-like waves swallowed up her home.
And the only child to survive?
The only child to survive is here. This one.
This past Saturday, marking the one-year anniversary, Dolor, her husband, and 13-year-old son visited this makeshift grave that holds her children and six other relatives.
I can just imagine them being happy in the presence of God.
12 months on, the Lingos have almost rebuilt their home. Dolor is busy with her children's ministry outreach.
We have a children's feeding program and a ministry to at-risk youth.
Amen.
Her husband, Dante, is busy leading a small church in the neighborhood.
Even though what happened to us is so painful, I know that in everything, God has a purpose for our lives.
And 13-year-old Dante Jr. has been playing drums in church.
For me, playing the drums lifts my spirit. Even though I lost my brothers and sister, I want to keep on playing.
The Lingos firmly believe that God is using the tragic death of their three children to point people in this neighborhood to Jesus Christ.
Most of our neighbors were unbelievers, but since the death of our children and the example that we've tried to be in the community, now many have become Christians and are attending our church.
The Lingos say they have a special burden for youth in their neighborhood.
A lot of the young kids sniffed glue and some of them gambled. We started reaching out and inviting them to church. At first they didn't want to come, but that has slowly changed.
The Lingos' testimony has reverberated throughout the community.
Before the typhoon, all the young people you see seated in the front row were unbelievers. But after the typhoon, the pastor encouraged us to serve and trust God. We did now. We are telling others about Christ. After the storm, I thought there was nothing left in life. Everything was destroyed. But then the pastor helped me realize that material things are not important. I'm happy that I'm here serving God.
Dante Jr. says he's tried to reach out to the other kids in the neighborhood, but finds it very difficult since he still misses playing with his siblings. He said he's studying hard in school and dreams of being a sailor one day. But for now, his heart is right here behind the drums.
I know God has a purpose for me because He spared my life.
It is a theme that runs through this precious family, devastated by unspeakable loss, yet determined to turn tragedy around for the glory and honor of God.
No matter what storms may come, calamity or tragedy, we must do our best to stand on our feet again and to keep our faith in God. No matter what happens, God is always there.
George Thomas, CBN News, Tacloban, Philippines.
Courage, resolute courage. God is always there. Isn't it amazing? All around the world, there are people who hope in God, and God loves them, and He knows who they are, and He knows their name. I mean, it's just wonderful to see, in spite of the difficulty they go through, that they love the Lord. Well, we've got a story coming up that you don't want to miss, and Wendy's going to tell us about it.
That's right. Up next, a young mom with a dark secret.
I just really stuffed that as far back as possible, and thinking that if I don't talk about it, if I don't deal with it, it's not going to come up.
Watch what happens when her secret is revealed after this.
Sex in America, pornography, magazines, strip clubs, triple X rated, on and on and on. It's a multi-billion dollar industry. But I've wondered, and I'm sure you have too, what would cause a young woman to enter into that business, to become a stripper, to stand and dance with no clothes on in front of a bunch of leering men? Well, for Polly Wright, it was about control. She wanted a chance to rule over men, because for most of her life, men ruled over her.
Shame kept me silent from my rape. Shame kept me silent from being sexually abused, because I thought that that's what I deserved.
At just 7 years old, Polly Wright began carrying a secret.
When your innocence is taken from you at a very young age, something breaks inside of you. And I believed it was my fault. Little girls are not made for sex.
And that was only the beginning. Polly was too ashamed of what happened to ask for help. She couldn't trust anyone except herself.
Started dabbling in drugs and alcohol myself when I was about 11, and that just continued down a really bad path and a bad spiral. During a drug deal when I was 14, I was the payment for drugs. I wasn't worth anything, just a bag of pot. So the fear was terrifying.
Tired of being used for sex, Polly saw an opportunity to turn the tables on men by dancing at a strip club. For once, she didn't feel the need to be ashamed.
Went there and just really had the sense that I would actually be able to control these men, that this is my chance to be able to tell them, you know, you can touch me or no, you can't. And if you do, you're gonna pay me for it. I'd have to be drunk to dance. Then I would dance and I'd be wasted. And then I would leave and I would go home with some guy or just go home and drink till I'd pass out.
For Polly, the money was good. But after a few years of the lifestyle and sleeping with countless men, the shame came back.
It is like a poison that just sits inside of you and just rots every part of your soul. And it compounded so much where I would, you know, start having thoughts of death. I didn't want to live anymore because what's the point?
After dancing one night, Polly sat in her car with a gun on her lap and thoughts of suicide on her mind.
I took the gun, and after just all those years of just not thinking that I'm worth anything to be alive, I drove around with the gun in my lap with every intention to take my life.
Polly didn't pull the trigger that day. She quit dancing, checked herself into rehab, and moved out of state, trying to run from her problems. She even met a man and soon got married.
And within 9 months of meeting, we got engaged, got pregnant, moved our wedding up, and ended up having twin baby girls.
Polly tried her best to be a normal wife and mother, but was still haunted by the shame of her past.
Having the realization of what the abuse had done with me, you know, I just really stuffed that as far back as possible. And thinking that if I don't talk about it, if I don't deal with it, it's not gonna come up. But what that did in my marriage with my husband is it would go where I couldn't even give myself to him. I didn't want to be touched. I couldn't have sex. And at home, I can't seem to even know who I am. And that depression, it's so self-consuming that you can't even give yourself to love properly.
After years of the shame and after years of the lies, Polly's husband encouraged her to go to church.
I'm sitting there and the women walk us through this exercise. So we're picturing Jesus and I'm picturing him and I am taking my hair and with my tears, washing his feet, but hearing his voice saying, "You are worthy. You are my daughter. And everything in your past has been forgiven. And I love you." And that broke me. And I got up from that because I couldn't sit at his feet anymore because I did not feel that. I did not feel worthy for his love.
But that started Polly on a journey, one she had never been on before. And one by one, the lies and the shame she lived with all of her life began to fall.
I'd never thought I was worthy of anything, to have love, to have this beautiful family, to have a marriage that's worth fighting for, worthy to be loved and to know what true love is. I never thought that. So that word would take me to my knees. And when Christ held my face and said, "You are worthy. You are a worthy daughter of a king, and I love you," it sped up time so much when I started capturing those lies that I was dirty because of all the sex I had and all the men that I let touch me. And God would say, "You are pure. You are a pure daughter, and I purify you. There is no other freedom. Nothing can give you freedom like that." And there is really, for me, no words for it, because it is It's beautiful. It's beautiful.
Man, I'll purify you. I'll purify you. Just think of that. How many men, dozens, had she had relations with? How many had ogled her naked body when she was dancing? How many had groped at her and fondled her and made obscene remarks about her and used her? To think of her own father selling her for a bag of marijuana. What a horrible background. And yet Jesus Christ looked at Polly and said, Polly, you're clean. You're my daughter. You're a daughter of the King. You're a handmaid of the Lord Jesus Christ. What have you done in your life? Listen, we're all sinners. Thank God He forgives sinners. Thank God that He will reach down and cleanse us, and He'll save to the uttermost those who come to God through Him. That's what it all means. That's why it's called good news. It's gospel, good news. I've come to bring relief. I've come to preach good tidings to the poor, the needy, the downtrodden, the captives. I've tried to set them free. Now, would you like to be free? Polly was in bondage for years. Did you do something you're ashamed of? Have you done something that you're ashamed of? Have you had an abortion? Have you murdered somebody? Have you had multiple sex partners and you're ashamed of it? Have you caught some sexual disease? What have you done? God says, I'll bring you to myself and make you my child. You are precious to me. Now, that's what God says. That's what I say as His servant. And I'm going to offer you the opportunity right now to say yes. All you've got to do is reach out and say, Lord, I take your gift. I take it. I take it now. And I want you to pray with me right at this moment, just like Polly did, and watch what happens. Do it. Wherever you are, just hold steady. Don't be doing anything else. Listen. Pray these words silently. Pray them out loud, but pray them. Jesus, that's right, say it. Jesus, I take your free gift. From this moment on, I want to be your child. I give you myself and all of the sins that come along with me. Everything I've done, I lay at the foot of your cross. And I take your cleansing, and I take your forgiveness. And Lord, I thank you. And from this moment on, I'm yours. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Now, if you prayed with me, I want to pray for you very quickly. Father, for everyone who prayed, let the anointing be there. May the peace be there. May the forgiveness flood their heart in the name of Jesus. Amen. If you prayed with me, I want to send you something. I don't want you just to start out and say, what happens next? I've got a little CD here that says what happens next. What is an exchange life? What does it mean to be born again? What does it mean to be a new creature in Christ? What if you sin after this experience? Well, what happens? What happens to you? And what will happen in the future when the Lord comes back? What about His second coming? And what about the baptism of the Holy Spirit? It's all in here. I'll give it to you free, but I want you to call and say, I prayed with Pat. If you don't want to give us your name, just call anyhow and say, look, I just prayed with that guy on TV, and hang up the phone if you want to. But if you'd like some help, somebody's here who loves you. So just pick up the phone. It's a toll-free number. No finances involved whatsoever. It's 1-800-759-0700. Isn't God good? Isn't God good? So thank Him and praise Him for what He's done for you right now. Let's go to Wendy.
All right. Thanks, Pat. Still ahead, we'll be answering your questions. Ava says, why do Christians who are ill fight so hard to stay on earth? I can't wait to get to heaven. We'll tackle that and much more later on the program.
And welcome back to the 700 Club for this CBN News Break. A big court victory for a Christian ministry challenging Obamacare's contraceptive mandate. A federal judge in Dallas has granted Pastor Chuck Swindoll's Insight for Living Ministries a temporary exemption from fines for not providing employees with certain birth control coverage. Swindoll's ministry considers the use of some contraceptive methods as forms of abortion, which violates their religious convictions. This is one of several similar cases moving through federal courts right now. A Christian school in Anchorage, Alaska says it will not host a wrestling tournament. This comes after school leaders were told they could not pray before the event. The tournament draws athletes from both public and private schools around the state. The Alaska School Activities Association received complaints about the prayers from someone attending the event last year. After being asked to stop praying, the school told the Activities Association it could no longer host the championship. School administrators say they were simply praying for safety and good sportsmanship. Remember, you can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website. It's cbnnews.com. Pat and Wendy are back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
To see this week's most viewed stories, go to cbn.com.
Welcome back to the 700 Club. Well, many children are scared of the dark, but Eliana's kids had a real reason to be afraid. They lived in an open plastic tent, and at night, it became infested with rats.
In her home, made out of plastic and tree limbs, 39-year-old Eliana has struggled trying to provide for her three small children. She earns money by washing people's clothes by hand. She told us living here wouldn't be so bad, except for the rats. Sometimes they bite the children while they're sleeping.
A rat bit me on my toe. It hurt me a lot. I was afraid to go to sleep because I was afraid that the rat would bite me.
The rats often came out at night while the house was completely dark because Eliana couldn't afford to pay for electricity.
I am very afraid of darkness.
When Operation Blessing met the family, we built them a sturdy new house away from the rats.
I'm happy for my new house. There are no rats anymore. I really like my house.
Then we had the electricity turned on. And to help the single mom expand her laundry business, we gave her a new washing machine.
This is amazing. I wash faster and for more people with the washing machine.
Now, with the increase in business, Eliana will be able to pay the electric bill and feed her kids.
Thank you, Operation Blessing, for our new house. We no longer live with the rats. Thank you for giving us hope.
You gave them more than hope. You gave them safety. When you give to the 700 Club and Operation Blessing, that's what you do. You change lives. And we want to bless you when you join right now. It's just 65 cents a day, $20 a month. The number on your screen, 1-800-759-0700. And when you call and say, yes, I want to partner with CBN. I want to change lives too. We want to bless you back with Living Under God's Blessing. This is Pat and Gordon's Dynamic New Teaching. This is free when you call right now and just say, yes, I want to join the 700 Club. So give us a call right now, or you can log on to cbn.com is another great way to give. Well, Pat is back in the hot seat, and we have some great questions.
Let's go for
you.
Them. All right.
Okay. Ava writes in, she says, Pat, I'm confused when Christians with cancer, for example, fight so hard to stay here on earth. I can't wait to get to heaven. Why would they fight so hard to stay here with their illness instead of surrendering and going into the loving arms of God and eternal life?
You don't have to ask them. I don't have an answer for that, except there's something innate in human beings. We want to stay alive. We want to live and not die. We want to live and glorify the Lord. I think that's His plan for us. There are a lot of people who want to die. And then, of course, you've got the suicide cult to think that's a good thing. But all I can say is, you ask me why, and the thing is, they have no control over their life, but what they would like to do is get healed of their disease. So if they're suffering from cancer, they want to get well. And I think, you know, God can take us. He doesn't have to give us cancer in order to take us out of here. All right.
All right. A viewer writes in, I have sinned and looked upon a woman with lust in my heart. I feel terrible about this, and these thoughts continue to rule my thinking. It causes guilt and condemnation to hover over my head. How can I end this repeated sin and thank God in the process for forgiving me?
You know, the Apostle Paul said something to people. He said, you know, it's for you who are not married, it's better to marry than to be consumed with lust. And what you're saying is that you have extraordinary urges. And what the Apostle Paul said is that you ought to get married and have a legitimate outlet for this stuff going on in your body. Beyond that, you know, the saint, I would call him a saint or a patriarch, Job, said, I made a covenant with mine eyes that I might not look upon a maid. It's very hard in today's world with Victoria's Secret and with all the porn and all of the advertising, mm-hmm. you know, features women, scantily clad types. And the reason is sex sells. And so they're out to get you with using that hook. So I just would say you make a covenant with your eyes. You focus on the Word of God. You focus on whatever things are holy, whatever things good, or whatever things pure, whatever the good report, the many virtue and the praise. Think on these things. You've got to think on it, but you cannot be turned into X-rated movies. You cannot be turning to some of the channels that are filled with, ratings and so forth. And think you're going to come out of it unscathed. So, I mean, I think that's what it is. But you say, how am I going to get rid of those thoughts? You've got to focus your thoughts. You've got to read the Word. You've got to concentrate on Jesus. You need to think about Him, talk to Him, pray to Him, ask for His cleansing and forgiveness. And it's an ongoing thing. And you die daily. The Apostle said of a truth, I die daily. Hmm. And all of us, the flesh needs to die daily. And if you're a human being, you've got fleshly desires. And there's nothing, I mean, it's nothing unusual about it, except you apparently yours is a little bit more extreme than others. But nevertheless, it's a human condition. So God knows you're human. He knows you're made out of dust. And he wants to work with you. That's all I can say. Mm-hmm. All right.
Good advice. All right.
Thank you.
Teresa writes in, after tithing, what is my biblical priority financially? Do I take care and help family first and then sow seed to God by the way of different organizations? Can I give tithes to help a homeless son or to help family members?
I think there's some confusion. A tithe should go to the work of the Lord, whether it is a mission, whether it is a foreign charity, whether it is a humanitarian organization at home, whether it is your local church, whatever. The tithe needs to go to God's work. So by taking care of your family, sick children or something, that's not your tithe. After then, of course, right. The Bible says if a man won't look after his own, he's worse than an infidel. So you have to look after your own family. And there's no question about that. But the tithe, that belongs to the Lord. And so you cannot take care of your kids and think you're tithing. That just mm-hmm. isn't a tithe.
All right. All right, this is an interesting one. Mathis writes in, my husband swears on his and others' loved ones' lives with his hand on the Bible that he's not lying about things that he is lying about. Bad things always seem to happen as a result. He just calls them coincidences, even though he admits that he was lying when he did that a number of times. He seems to have no moral or spiritual stop sign to make him stop hurting us, his wife and daughters. What should I do? I feel like I'm married to the devil himself.
Well, leave him. Leave him. I'm serious. He needs counseling. I mean, he's calling down a curse from God on himself. I mean, you talk about stupid. I mean, he's raising his hand to God Almighty and asking God to strike him. I mean, he's defying God. I just wouldn't do that. I mean, I fear the Lord. I wouldn't want to stand against God. But in your case, if you can't stand this any longer, you could get a trial separation and see what would happen. Or else tell him if he doesn't get counseling and get straightened out on this thing, you're going to leave him. But you can't put up with that. And you got a guy who's a habitual liar.
Yeah.
But anybody who will swear, he'll bring in a curse not only on himself, mm-hmm. but on his whole family.
Yeah. All right. Well, Josie writes, is it true that when we die, we automatically go to heaven or hell? Or do we get judged first?
Well, as I read the Bible, It seems like there's an intermediate stage. You know, Jesus said to the thief on the cross, this day you'll be with me in paradise. But there is a paradise for the good people, and there's a Hades for those who are not so good. But the final judgment will come after the great white throne, when the Lord wraps it all up, and he's just in his throne, and the books will be open, and all people everywhere will be judged. So, and then there'll be a final settling of either going to hell or going to heaven, giving a new body, etc. But I won't go into all that. But yeah. I think the Apostle Paul said, I'm in a strait betwixt two, whether to depart and be with the Lord, which is far better, or to remain in the flesh, which is needful for you. So he had two choices, stay around and preach and help the church, or be taken out of here when he would be with the Lord. So that's what the Bible says. Okay.
Amen. That's good news.
That's good news.
All right.
Amen.
All right. Thanks
well,
for this.
It may not be the fountain of youth, but it's the next best thing. Hear how to reverse the effects of aging after this.
Well, believe it or not, some scientists think that the first person who will live to the age of 150 has already been born. Researchers are making breakthrough discoveries and unlocking the secrets to longer life. So how can we stay younger longer? Just watch.
Even though we can't stay young forever, Dr. Richard Furman says there are steps we can take to live younger longer. Dr. Furman has been a vascular surgeon for over 30 years and says health problems associated with age can be prevented. In his book, Prescription for Life, Dr. Furman shares his strategic plan for maintaining the healthiest body possible, now and throughout our golden years.
And Dr. Richard Furman is here with us now. His book is called Prescription for Life, Three Simple Strategies to Live Younger Longer. And it's so nice to meet you, the man who's going to keep us younger longer. And, you know, you have shocking statistics in your book. Half of all Americans will die because of what is going on in their arteries. Tell us, what's going on in our arteries?
Well, Wendy, the health of our arteries determines the aging process. And just real quickly, there's good cholesterol and there's bad cholesterol. The bad cholesterol, the LDL cholesterol, is like little splinters that gets into your arteries. The good cholesterol, the hero HDL, takes those little splinters out. And that aging process is going on in everyone.
Well, one of the scary things, we may never have any symptoms of arterial damage until we get a stroke or even die. So how can we tell if we have a problem?
That's the scary part, and that's what Prescription for Life is all about prevention, because 80% of everyone over the age of 50 has some significant blockage in their arteries without causing any symptoms. That's the heart, the brain.
Significant blockage.
That's the blockage, significant blockage. So you don't want to wait till symptoms. Two-thirds of the time with a heart attack, the first symptom is a full-blown heart attack. So don't wait on symptoms.
Sorry to interrupt. That blockage is caused from what we're eating, right?
Caused from that bad cholesterol they were eating, the wrong foods.
So the bacon that we love.
Right.
Okay, we're going to get to that in a minute. But you said that the clogging of the arteries, it leads to more than just heart disease. You've also say it's linked to Alzheimer's. How so?
Well, there's a lot. I think the Prescription for Life is a review of the medical literature written in layman's terms. And there's one good article, the Journal of the American Medical Association, that I think says it all. That Alzheimer's, they took 1,800 people, followed them for 14 years, and this is what they found. The ones that ate properly, like we're talking about, against the ones that didn't eat properly, they had a 40% more chance of Alzheimer's than the ones that ate poorly.
Okay, so what are the three lifestyle changes that we all need to make if we want to live in younger, longer?
Well, there are only three that we have control of, and that's the foods that we eat or we don't eat, our weight, we determine our own weight, nobody forces us to eat, and whether we exercise or not.
Well, let's start with the foods. We already know the bad foods that we shouldn't eat. Well, we know the good foods we should eat. We know the fruits and the vegetables and the lean meats and fish. What are foods that we should be avoiding at all costs?
Well, there are six. We won't have time to go in all six, but I'll tell you, the one food that Americans eat the most of, that gives us the most saturated fat, that gives us those little splinters, the LDL cholesterol splinters, is cheese.
Really? I love cheese. You're kidding.
That was my favorite food. All my patients brought me cheese at Christmas. But I read that article, and in that moment I said, you know, I don't want my last 10, 15 years to be drooling, to be terrible last years of my life. Plus, you can be physiologically younger now. So I gave up cheese. If I could have given that up, anybody could.
I thought you were going to say, you know, bacon because it's pure fat and delicious, or a big juicy steak. But you're saying cheese. It's amazing. But look at the French. They eat less of cheese, and they're slender, and I don't know how long they live. They might not live to be 150. But, okay, so let's move on to maintaining our weight is number two thing that we need to do to live healthier longer. What is a healthy weight?
Well, the BMI is what the government goes by, but it gives you like a 30 or 40 pound difference. Go to prescriptionforlife.com and explain how to get to an ideal weight. But the main thing is less than 12% of Americans are at ideal weight, so don't worry about that. Assume you are overweight, and how do you get that excess weight off? And that's the key.
And then just how dangerous is a sedentary life? We know exercise is actually, that's the number three thing, a life of exercise.
Right.
How dangerous to our arteries is a sedentary life?
It's probably one of the most dangerous things that we do, and over half of Americans are completely sedentary. They don't do any exercise at all. And it takes 6 or 7 years off of your life expectancy. If you can't walk a quarter of a mile in 5 minutes, you're 30% more likely to die in the next 3 years than someone who can. And those are pretty tough numbers, but it puts it in perspective how important to get off that couch. And even if you're just going to do brisk walking, you need an exercise plan that you're going to follow yourself, even if it's brisk walking, because that emphasizes to you what else you need to be doing.
Okay, so if you eat a little piece of cheese and then you go for a brisk walk, are you going to counter those? Are they going to roll each other out?
No, these three lifestyles intertwine.
I'm trying, people. I'm trying to get us to be able to eat cheese here.
They intertwine.
Okay.
And you can't pick one or two and leave the other one out. And there's many stories in Prescription of Life that explain someone that looks, a football coach that looks healthy, right. He exercises good weight, but he had the highest cholesterol I've ever seen reported. And we put him on this plan, and in 2 months, he had normal cholesterol.
Okay.
So that's the one thing he was leaving out was the food. So you can't, you've got to do them all three.
All right. Well, we will forgive you about the cheese if it helps us to live younger, longer.
Right.
Dr. Furman, it was a pleasure. And if you want more of his insight, and I know you do, into the three simple strategies, you can get his book. It's called Prescription for Life, and it's available in stores nationwide. God bless you, and thanks so much for sharing your insights.
Well, thanks for having me, Wendy.
Pat?
Thank you.
I like cheese. I'm sorry. Well, we leave you with today's Power Minute from Psalm 34. Those who seek the Lord shall not lack any good thing. Tomorrow, a woman who beat an unbeatable disease. Hear how she survived MS on Friday. We'll see you then.